How's everyone today? I know we're nearing the end of the conference, so energy might be a little bit low. I know it is for me, but I'm really, really excited to be here, and I'm really excited to talk to you about automation. And in this talk, I'm going to be talking about specifically the automation tools that we as business owners might be using to streamline our system. So I'm not necessarily going to be talking about, you know, giant AI or anything really high level like that. Talking about those little things that we use every day to save us time, save us money, save us effort. So a little bit about me. My name is Allie. I work as a support tech at GiveWP, which is a donation plugin. I have a business called Pixable Web Design, which I'm actually in the process of reformatting to be less web design, more website maintenance. I am a GoDaddy Pro Speaker Master, as you might be able to see from my shirt, or you might have seen me outside bugging people to talk to them about GoDaddy Pro. I'm from Miami, Florida, so I have traveled quite a ways to be here with you guys today, and I'm very, very newly engaged, so that's something that I talk about a lot. Really quick, if anyone has their phone or their computer out with them at the moment, go to slido.com and enter in that code. There's going to be a poll on that page. And the poll is basically going to ask you, what do you most use your automation tools for? It's going to give you three options. You use your automation tools to save you time. Do you find that you use them most because you want to save money? Or are you trying to save effort? Are you trying to make your life easier? I'll give you just a couple seconds to go ahead and get here and insert this information in, because I want to know what you guys use your automation tools for. And at the end, I'll go ahead and we can look at the data together and see how we feel about it. I did a brief poll on Twitter a little while ago, and I thought my hypothesis was that money was going to be the number one. I was really surprised that the number one reason, I mean, 55% is a pretty close race, but ease struck out over everything else, right? We want automation to make our lives simpler, easier, so that we can relax, right? So we can have more energy to do the things that matter to us. So I wanted to show you guys this, just to see if this lines up with the way that you feel. And if you think that this applies to you. And in doing research for this talk, I looked at a lot of automation sites, right? A lot of sites for the tools that we use. I'm not going to name any, but I basically just typed in, you know, small business automation tools, or agency automation tools, or freelancer automation tools. And this is a lot of the marketing research that I saw. Right? So taking things off your to-do list so you can focus, right? More customers for less effort, which basically means more money for less effort, right? Pre-built, ready-made, one click, right? These are all time-saving things. Doing things for you, freeing up your time. Time, money, ease. These are the messages I kept seeing over and over and over again. And I realized two things about automation. It does make our lives easier, it's supposed to, but it becomes overwhelming, it becomes more stressful, it becomes more difficult for us, the business owner or the freelancer, when it takes too much time or money to manage. When that goal of saving time or money ends up going backwards on us. And the other important thing, which I don't think we think about, is that it becomes overwhelming for the client, for the people that we deal with, when it causes unnecessary friction, when it causes them to go out of their way to use that tool or implement that tool, even if it makes our life easier. And at the end of the day, isn't what we do for the client? Aren't we using WordPress or using the systems and the tools that we use to make life easier for other people? I think so. So, there's a show I really like called Doctor Who. And whenever I think about robots and automation, you know, robots taking over everything, I think about the Cybermen, create these giant robots, for you know, simpler term. But I also thought about the Doctor, and if you're not familiar with the show, basically he has this giant time and space machine that sort of has a mind of its own, and she goes wherever she feels like going. And he's constantly wrangling her and trying to be like, you know, I'm trying to go to 18th century France. Why are we in the year 2285 on the planet Zorgon, whatever? And so my argument for you guys today is to be like the Doctor, right? Wrangle your machines, wrangle your automation. Maintain, even though technically he's not a human, maintain the human element within your automation. Because otherwise we end up with the Cybermen, who are robots with no humanity, no souls, and they want everything else to be robots like them. And anything that cannot be a robot like them needs to be exterminated. So, most simply, my argument is maintaining the human element within our automation to prevent that overwhelm, to prevent that stress, to prevent it from running away without us, and that's basically my argument. So I'm going to talk about some specific forms of automation that we might use and be familiar with, and I'm going to start with email responders, right? Those things that we might have up right now that tell people, hey, I know you're trying to get in touch with me, however, XYZ. And in doing some research, I found this graph, which is basically the time expectancy people have in order to receive a response to an email. And I found it really interesting that it basically goes through this bell curve, where within 24 hours, people are not that expected to receive a response. You know, 4 hours goes by, I haven't gotten a response, not that big of a deal. Once we hit that 1 day mark, we want that response. We're waiting for that response. And then after that day has passed, more unacceptable that we haven't gotten a response yet. So I feel like a lot of people feel this, they understand this, they think, okay, I need to reply as soon as I can. If a potential customer is trying to get in touch with me, I can't let that 1 day go by without them hearing from me, or else they're going to go somewhere else. So let's take a minute and look at a couple of examples of email responders that I've seen, that you may have seen as well. This is the first one. Hello, you've reached Allie. I'm not currently at my computer, but I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Seems pretty harmless. I've had email responders where I emailed the person, they sent this to me automatically, and then within 10 minutes I get a response. Weird. I'll reply, and then I get this again. And then they reply within the same day, and then I get this a third time. I think it kind of goes without saying that that's a little bit ridiculous, right? But that person wants to make sure that if they can't get in touch with me, I still get a message back. The next one. This is one that a boss of mine used to send. Hi, I'm currently basking in the sweet waters off the coast of Key West while I celebrate the launch of my amazing new book, How to Write Great Email Responses. Use code CRINGE to get 20% off. You're laughing, so I think you understand why this is pretty lame, right? This is a sales tool at this point. This person is not thinking about me or what I need or why I emailed them. They are bragging, and they're trying to get me to buy a book. Not fun. The third example. Hi, thank you for your message. I'm currently out of town. I'll return on November 1st. If this is an emergency, please call Louise, and she'll assist until I'm able to get in touch. The difference to me between these three things, cringiness aside of that second one, there's humanity in this third option. They are looking at me as a person who has a need, and they're giving me information. They're telling me when they're going to be back, and they're giving me a second option of how I can get my problem solved. This is what I think an email response should look like, and this is the email responder that I tend to use when I need to use it. So I feel like this example was a little bit kind of low-hanging fruit, but just to kind of get you an idea of what I want to talk about today, of making sure that everything you do when you're using automation involves that human element. So for those first two didn't give me any information about when I can actually expect to receive a response. It didn't give me anything to do in the meantime. So how helpful was that to the person that was emailing you? But when we use them properly, they save us time. They can close a deal sooner by maintaining that relationship. And they prevent that uncertainty, right? They give me another option of something to work. Appointment scheduling. I am a millennial. I don't like talking on the phone. I really don't. But what I've learned is that's not a universal experience. I thought it was. I thought that the more we were going into the 21st century, and the more that we were automating, people don't want to use phones anymore. But in this research that I did, I found this graph, and it basically asks, how do you usually book appointments with service providers? And it's, you know, doctors, hairdressers, but I think we kind of, we fall into the service provider area, so I think this data is sufficient for this argument. 50% of people said phone call. Versus all those other options, right? Online is still pretty up there, but 50% of people say, I want to talk to you on the phone. That's pretty compelling information to me. However, within the same study, when asked, what's your preferred way of canceling or rescheduling something, 52% say, I want to be able to go online to do it. I want the automation here. I want it to be quicker. We still have 33% that say they want to be able to call. So what these two pieces of data tell me is that we need to provide choice, right? And choice is that human element. And I honestly didn't do this for a long time running my business. I just had an automated scheduling tool that I worked with. And I probably lost a lot of business by isolating those people who wanted the ability to call me just because I wanted my life to be easier by not having. So we become more overwhelmed, or we become more stressed, or we find inefficiency here when we limit the options for the people that we're working with, when we're blocking those new connections, when we're leaving that service or that money on the table, and when we're wasting time with phone tag. When you have to chase after somebody because, you know, if you only have phones, for example, if they try to call you and they miss you and so on and so forth, we're misusing this communication, but we are ending up being less overwhelmed. We're using the automation tool properly, and it saves us time. We're closing that deal sooner, and we're providing options. Billing. Auto billing is probably my least favorite thing because it makes me feel like a bank, but I have monthly recurring revenue that I have, so it makes my life a lot easier to just have money show up in my bank account without me having to do anything. However, I have gotten this situation where somebody's card information has changed and they don't receive an invoice from me. So they have no way of changing it. And because they don't get an invoice from me, it probably just escapes their memory that they even need to update it with me in the first place. I found this bit of info, which basically talks about the top challenges for recurring revenue. And the number one top challenge that the people in this survey noted was customer engagement. And I thought that was really compelling, that when we have these recurring services, we're not engaging with people. We're not reminding them that, hey, I'm keeping your site updated, I'm taking your backups, I'm doing all of this stuff to optimize your experience, but you're not seeing it. I'm not including you, the human element, in this experience. So what ends up happening? We might lose that business. That person sort of thinks to themselves, well, what are you even doing for me? What am I paying you all this money every month for? And we end up losing that business. So we end up experiencing more overwhelm with the system when we end up wasting time with errors, right? Having to now call that person because their credit card is out of date and they don't get back to you and you go weeks without being paid because that system is not easy for them. And we disassociate the cost with the service. We don't engage and we lose that business. If you're using it properly, right, maybe if you have recurring sending that invoice first to say, hey, here's your invoice, you will be automatically billed, and then sending up a follow-up, a report of some kind that says, here's all the laundry list of things that I did for you, and the reason why you're paying me, that provides that engagement opportunity, and it saves us that time of having to do that back and forth. CRMs. I've always been a very small business, so I've not used CRMs very much. I used to work at an agency where my boss thought that having a CRM was like having a direct connection to God or something. That if he could figure out how to unlock the secret of using a CRM, he would just have unlimited business forever. I don't think that that's true. If you figured out how to do that, please let me know. But I found this bit of information, this pro and con list, which outlines all of the ways in which using a CRM properly can help us, right? And all of the ways using it improperly hurt us. And I was kind of mad when I found this graph, because I was like, hey, they just kind of did my presentation for me as far as this part of the section goes. The ability to actually implement your CRM properly begins with that human element of thinking about, what do I need my CRM to do? What do I need it to do that I can't do myself, or that is impossible or not realistic for me to do myself? And I think we want a CRM that just sort of runs our customer funnel for us. But again, that is removing the human element. So I never really used a CRM very much, but what I did was I used Trello every time I made a new connection with somebody. And I wrote down their information, I wrote down a date, and I pasted in that message in that Trello board. And I set a timer for myself of 2 weeks. Or maybe if I talked to them, they said, hey, I'm gonna be ready in November for a new site. Can you contact me then? Making that note. A lot of CRMs will automate that entire process for you, and then send the message for you, and then send follow-ups for you. But I knew that if I did something like that, I would not build a connection with that person. I would be sending just bots, basically, to that person. And I don't think that that's entirely helpful. So CRMs cause us more overwhelm. Basically, when they waste our time and they waste our money. A lot of people, I've heard a lot of people talk about, you know, signing up with a CRM, getting really, really excited, and just wasting a ton of time setting it up improperly, or trying to overuse it, and it ends up not working out. But if we can find a system, design our own system, use parts of the CRM that we think are going to be more efficient for us, we can save some time, earn that extra revenue, and close the deal sooner. Social media scheduling. This is probably one of the more popular forms of automation, I think, for businesses. However, I think we forget the social of social media. It's not called automated media, it's not called robot media, it's not called machine media, it is social media. So I see stuff like this all the time, especially when I was first starting out. You know, these kind of infographics telling us when we need to post, to automate our expectation about how we should be posting on social media. I don't know about you, but ever since I started attending WordCamps, I get most of my Twitter engagement on the weekends, because WordCamps happen on the weekends. So this infographic that tells me that Saturday and Sunday are the worst days to post on Twitter removes me from my own system. It removes my human element, the connection that I'm making with you guys, from the system. I see a lot of messages like this sometimes, and I don't think there's anything wrong with reaching out when somebody follows you on Twitter to say, hey, thanks for engaging with me. Thank you for following me. Thanks for thinking I'm interesting enough. But when it looks like that, I don't feel special anymore. I feel like just another number to this person. And maybe not even that, because they might not even seen that I follow them. And I think that this really tends to push people away. This is list to eat, right? Good morning, shooters. Happy Friday. Weekend plans? That date, July 20th, 2012, that was about 2 hours after the Aurora shooting in Colorado that this automated tweet went out. They completely removed their human element from this system, and so nobody was able to think to themselves, hey, that's massively inappropriate to post today. We should maybe cancel this tweet. For ourselves when it comes to social media scheduling. We waste our own time by setting all this stuff up, and we don't get any real engagement from it because it's not real engagement to begin with. We waste our money if we purchase any of these tools or if we hire someone to do it for us. And we hurt our brand with all of this awkwardness and all of this inauthenticity that people pick up on. People are aware now, very aware of when this stuff is faked. But if we can automate properly, right, sending out automated tweets when necessary, I'm sure that the WordCamp Boston team sent out some automated tweets for this event. But I probably wouldn't really notice that because they have so many authentic tweets that are being sent out in real time. We can save time and we can create more engagement when we do it properly. Website maintenance. So to share a personal story, which is a pretty embarrassing one, but I'm going to share it anyway. For the longest time doing website maintenance, for the past 2.5 years, I would do the services that I was hired to do, I would bill my clients, and I would not follow up with them. I wouldn't send out reports, I wouldn't send out daily check-ins or monthly check-ins. I was just trucking along. And so I had this client, Marla, who I built a site for. It was a small site, like 4 pages. And I spent a year doing week maintenance for her. Did a fantastic job. She never asked me for anything. She was a really easy client. She had maybe 1 or 2 questions within that year. And when I emailed her to let her know that her contract was expiring and if she wanted to renew, this is the email that she sent me, that she took a WordPress class and she will be able to maintain her own site from now on. I never proved to her that it was worthwhile to continue paying me for my service. I removed that human element, I automated the entire thing, and even though I did a great job and her site operated perfectly, it ran quickly, she got engagement and she got sales through it, she did not believe that she needed me because I removed myself from this system. I found this graphic image. Basically, it's just for the recording, it's a kind of infinity symbol that goes through productize, optimize, monetize, and serve. But in the middle is engage. And when we do all of this other stuff, it can work perfectly. We can do all of these other things to a T, but when we don't engage, it doesn't mean anything. Because we're human beings. And we like connecting to each other. So when you over-automate these systems, we end up wasting time, we end up wasting that money, and we break that cycle, that recurring revenue cycle, because we leave that human element out of it, and so it seems worth less to that client. But we can make it work better for us, and it'll save us that time. If I had connected with her more, yeah, it would have taken me a little bit more time, but I would have kept that client, and I would not have to then go and try and find another person to fill that gap in my revenue. We earn more money just at the end of the day by keeping clients, and it encourages new business, because I lost Marla as a client now. She spent a year paying me, and she didn't understand what she was paying me for, and I'm sure in her eyes, to her, it was a waste of time, and it was a waste of money. So for me to get new business from her, if she needed a new website, she might not come to me. Or if she has a problem with that site, she may go to that WordPress class that she went to, and not to me, because I didn't prove my worth to her. Bottom line, bots and automated DMs. Just don't do it, please. Just stop it. In looking for examples, I found a lot of these really terrible automatic direct messages we get through social media. In this one, this company is every couple of months sends literally the same DM to this woman, and she goes, "Are you going to DM me the same thing every 2 months? Please say no." And they sent her the same DM again. What kind of connection are you making with this interaction? I found this bit of data that was really amazing, and it's basically asking the question, to what extent do you trust the following forms of advertising? It goes from trust completely, don't trust much at all. The ones that are trusted, the top, five, recommendations for people you already know, other people's reviews, newspaper articles, branded websites, and emails that I signed up for. Those were the top five things that people trusted, right? And those are all very kind of human element things. These are things that I've chosen to engage with. These are people that I know. Everything else on the bottom are ads. Every single one of those is a form of an ad. From ads on TV, which are the most trusted ads, which surprised me a little bit, to text ads on mobile phones. So, again, I feel like I might be just preaching to the choir or saying something super obvious that people don't trust ads. But as we move forward into the super technological age that we're in, people are smart. They recognize when they're being given an ad, and they know that it's disingenuous. Have you guys ever gotten a LinkedIn email that looks like this? Seeing some nods, seeing some smiles. In and of itself, it's not terrible, you know. It's a decent message. Regardless of the fact that he's trying to sell me services that I list, that I provide in my LinkedIn profile. And I think the first time I got one of these, I was like, you just didn't read my profile. But, like, you know, honest mistake. And I got another one. And then I got another one, and then I stopped using LinkedIn. Because for some reason, I believe, and I apologize if anyone here works at or for or with LinkedIn, it's set up to be so disingenuous. Like that whenever somebody gets a new job or something, and you can click, "Congrats on your new job." And so when I just started my new job at GIF, I got about four of those, "Congrats on your new job." And I'm like, okay, did you really mean that? Or are you just automating your engagement? Are you automating those DMs in the hope that I will be tricked into thinking that you really put thought into that message? Maybe I'm overly critical, but I don't care for that feature. Here's an example of an automated DM, and I have no proof that this is an automated DM, but I'm pretty certain it is, that I like. Basically says, "Hey Nathan, thank you so much for following me. I hope my content brings value to your everyday life. If you have any questions, concerns, or simply want to chat, please feel free to reach out. I'd love to know about each of my followers and their stories. Have a great day." They're not trying to sell anything. They're not asking for anything. They're not asking you to go to a site or download an ebook or follow them back or like a post. Even if this is automated, it's so human. It's saying, "Hey, thank you, I appreciate you. If you reach out to me, I will reach back out to you." This is something I could imagine actually engaging with. And this is the flip side of a successful, I think, automated direct message. The company says, "Thank you for checking out Fernie and using Twitter to get in touch. Select an option below to get automated help, or tap talk to an agent, or just type any message to get connected with a real human for help." And then it has three at the bottom, probably common questions that they get. What's the status of my order? Ask a question, talk to an agent. So it's telling me that this is a bot. It's that this is a bot, but it's giving me an option. It's giving me a way to actually bring in the human element so that I can choose what kind of interaction I want to have. But it's not trying to trick me into thinking that it's a real person. So I think automated DMs, in most cases, just waste all the resources. It wastes your time, it wastes your money, it creates friction. Why did I open up this DM if it's just a robot that I don't want to talk to? And it can drive away business. I've followed brands or influencers or people who then send me an automated message and I immediately unfollow them. Because that's just not the interaction I want to have on my social media. But when we do it properly, right, with those last two messages, we save time. If that second one went through to me from maybe like Amazon or something, and I did want to talk to someone, I just now have a frictionless experience of instead of me having to find contact information, I can just go ahead and do that right there. We earn ourselves more connections by being genuine with these messages and not asking so much of the people we're connecting with. We offer choice and we offer information. And for me, the human element is about choice. So here are a couple of automated tools that I really like and that I use and that I think give you a wide variety and a range of ways to automate, but without automating your humanity away, without, you know, isolating the people that you are interacting with. So Wave is what I would use for invoicing, reporting tools as far as my finances go, and automated, recurring revenue, things like that. Later is for specifically Instagram automated DMs, where you can schedule out your posts, but you have to select go on the date and time. So it'll send you a little notification and you say, yes, I'd like to ship that out. So that if this is a day where you really shouldn't send that message, you can stop it. GoDaddy Pro. I'm here to talk about GoDaddy Pro right outside, and it's a part of my systems to be able to automate my website management in a way that puts me entirely in control of the experience and allows me to send reports to my clients, which thankfully I figured out how to do. And Calendly, which is what I use for scheduling with people. But now I also offer phone calls in addition to that. So the question is, does automation cause more or less overwhelm, right? That's the topic, that's the name on the tin. And it depends, right? It depends on how we choose to use it, because we are the humans, we are the ones with the power. Here are all of my sources for all of those bits of data that I found. And I do want to look over here at the slideshow just to see what you guys, what your thoughts were. Oh, 18 votes, thank you. Oops. The results, there we go. Wow. So, the results of this poll are pretty much identical to the Twitter results that I got. So that's pretty powerful. What did we say? So on Twitter, when I told people, it said 40% wanted to save time. You guys, 44% of you wanted to save time. 5% wanted to save money on Twitter. 6% of you guys wanted to save money. Making life easier came out to 55%. 50% of you said making your life easier. So, I mean, it's not a huge data set, 18 and 20 votes, but that's kind of remarkable. So thank you for adding to that data and for reconfirming this information. I think I have a couple of minutes if anybody has questions. Yeah?
Regarding the engagement for your maintenance plan, what does that look like? What would you do differently that didn't work for our
So the question was regarding website maintenance and engagement, what do I do differently now since getting that message from Marla? Reporting. Every month, sending out a report that says, these are the plugins that I updated, these are the backups that I've taken. I offer like basic content updates and stuff like that. So this is the work that you've requested that I've done, that you've gotten, and just sending that every month and being a bug in their ear and reminding them consistently that I am doing work for them and this is where their money has gone. That's what I've started doing, and I haven't lost a client since that. Yes?
So, I've worked with clients that I find, I've worked with clients that some I find, the auditory piece that you're talking about, and I've also worked with some that, would prepare automation for me directly from home. Wonder if you had any thought on how to best feel that out, and, how to, I guess, change your process to fit the client early on instead of
So the question was, he has clients, some of them prefer more of the human element, some of them just like getting the automated messages, and that's okay. So how do you fit that into your systems? Choice. Maybe now that you've recognized that that's a trend or that that's a thing, when you start working with somebody, maybe just say, how do you, these are the two options that I provide. How do you prefer to get this messaging? And again, it might cause you more time and a little bit more effort to segment that experience, but I think that you are really working the human element then into that system, that onboarding system, right? Versus, that's another good point, is if you just said, okay, everyone's going to get treated the same, in a way you're automating your onboarding system. So if you add that human element, give them the choice of how they choose to get that information, I think, in my experience so far, people really, really appreciate that sort of thing. Appreciate having the choice. Appreciate their needs and their convenience being met over what's going to be easiest for you in the business. Does that answer the question?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Any other questions? How much time do I have left? 2 minutes. Okay. Yes, about...
I was having a little bit of trouble pulling up the URL, so I'm not sure if it's on my end or yours.
And so
I said I'm having a little trouble pulling up the URL for the deck. I don't know if it's on my end or yours.
I will be uploading, thank you so much, I should have mentioned that previously. I will be uploading the deck directly when I get off the stage. Pro booth. If anybody else has any questions or wants to chat, please. Thank you so much.